this is Abigail Gomez, your instructor in Hello everyone, I am Abigail Gomez, your instructor for multimedia journalism. This is already the fourth leg of our discussion in overcoming social media addiction through detoxing. So the first session that we had focused on facts and figures about social media. Then the second is to assess if you are a social media addict. Then the third is what you can do or what happens to you when you have a social media addiction. These are the good habits and also the bad habits. And then this is the last leg. So this is how do I detox from social media. So what you can always do to start off is to disconnect in order to reconnect. Just like any other Meralco bill or PLDT bill or Globe or even your postpaid mobile phones, there are times that when we get disconnected, of course, we are agitated because we were not able to pay our bills. However, this would be the times that we can become more productive because we are not connected to any of our, let's say, mobile phones, our telephones. So because of that, we were able to reconnect to other things like our family, to our relatives. So our world is no longer being manipulated by telecommunications. We are now already living in the sense that we are reconnecting with other people. So it is a very good thing that we are disconnecting at times so that we can reconnect to other people. And there are different tips that we can do in order to disconnect and reconnect. First is, you can always track your current social media usage. There are different tools or applications that you can download via Google Play Store or the App Store. And these are some of the apps that we can have. First is the Antisocial. So it actually tracks your social media usage, the number of hours you are spending on such social media. And also it shows you where you are being distracted or how many times are you checking in on a particular application. And then the second application that I can share to you is the Forest. The Forest is like a Pomodoro technique. If you're familiar with a Pomodoro, and maybe if you're cooking at home, you might be familiar with this Pomodoro. So the Pomodoro is the tomato timer. So it is actually set for 25 minutes. It's like an alarm clock when you're cooking. So you use that when you are baking so that you can track the time for your food to be cooked or to be baked. But you can actually use that Pomodoro technique in your daily habits or daily things that you're doing. So you set things for every 25 minutes. And for the 25 minutes, you're not doing any other thing else. For example, for this video, I am focusing that this hour, I would be allotting this time just to do this video. And then, so first, you have to choose the task that you'd like to get done. And that is the sample. Next, set your Pomodoro for 25 minutes. Of course, if you don't have a Pomodoro, you just set your alarm clock. And if not the alarm clock, you just set your time. So just make sure that from 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock, from 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock, you get things done for that particular time. And then you work on the task until your alarm or the Pomodoro rings. So that is the time that you would be amazed because, oh my God, I've done so much within an hour, within one Pomodoro, or within just 25 minutes, I've done so much. And I never thought I would be able to do that if there are so many distractions. So when the Pomodoro rings, put a check mark on a paper. So you can see that you have done a thing. Sometimes this is what I do. I put a list on what I need to do. Although the list goes on and on and on because because of the nature of my job, it just goes on and it's like an endless list. But whenever you see that you have checked something, okay, this task done, another task done, and then you can see your progress. You know you've been productive. Okay. Then, of course, take a short break. So for every 25 minutes of working, then maybe you can have 5 minutes of rest, and that resting still does not involve any social media application. Then for every 4 Pomodoros, or for every, so how many would that be? 100 minutes, 25, 50, yeah, 100 minutes, and then you can take a longer break. So that might be around 30 minutes or 20 minutes. Okay, but just make sure that you stay away from your phones. You don't rest by going into social media. That is not resting. So in summary, this is the Pomodoro technique as drawn by Francesco Cirillo. Okay, so first plan your tasks and how many Pomodoros do you need. Do one Pomodoro, okay, 25 minutes, then 5 minute break. So that would be the timeline that we have. And then repeat it with 4 Pomodoros, then take a longer break. This is what you can actually do when you are so busy. Okay. It is true that when you are busy, at times what you do is you're doing something, then you are distracted by another thing to be done, and then you kept on doing that thing and you kept on forgetting the other one. So you are not progressing. So what you're doing is just to pile up more job, more things to be done. Okay, now transform your time from being an enemy to being an ally in order to achieve your goals. Take your regular breaks, learn to observe yourself and your team, and improve your work process. Okay, so what we always say is, I have no time. Kulang na ako sa oras. Wala akong oras. Wala na akong time for that. Okay, so because we always take a look at time as our enemy. And maybe some of you are awake until the wee hours of the morning. So you will always say that you lack time. If you are really doing many things at once, then yes, you will. If you're a working student, then yes, you will. You will really lack time, but how will you transform time into your friend? Then maybe that's one of the things that you can do. Detox from your social media. Remove your stressors. Remove your distractions. Next, set your unplug hours. You may use your Pomodoro. 2 Pomodoros with your family in the morning and in the afternoon will do. So when I say Pomodoro, that would be again 25 minutes. So spend 50 minutes with your family, especially this time that we are at home. So just make sure that you don't miss them out. You're at home, but it's like you're invisible. That's not good. So if you're at home, make sure that you are with your family. Okay? So you can also do some 48 hours of unplugging. So when we say 48 hours, maybe that would be Saturday and Sunday, because 2 days off from work, from schooling, that's the time that you can unplug, connect, and also reflect on what you are doing in life. Third, set or designate a no phone zone. Okay, so just imagine that you always bring your phone wherever you go, but you should designate a no phone zone. Just like, do not put your phone beside the stove when you're in the kitchen. So even if you say that, Mom, but I'm watching it in YouTube, what I'm doing is being trapped in YouTube because that's where I get the process. Okay, but maybe you can watch it beforehand before you go to the kitchen, right? Or if you want, you watch it, and while you are watching, you take down notes and bring that note into the kitchen instead of your mobile phone. Remember, it's still dangerous to have your device near any gas or electrical. Okay, I think that is more of surges, electrical surges or motivators of fire. Okay, so you have to avoid it. And then, of course, no phones on the dining table. You can actually set some rules with your family. If somebody would be bringing a phone on the kitchen, on the dining table, then that might be amounting to 100 pesos or they will be charged for bringing their phones on the dining table. Of course, no phones in the CR or in the washroom, okay? Because gadget plus water is a no-no, so it's delicate. Well, maybe you can just go back to the primitive times wherein you are using, you are reading newspapers in the CR or magazines when you are doing your routines, right? Okay, instead of your cell phone. Because remember, while you are doing that, sometimes you're just engrossed with what you are, with what you are seeing on your phone instead of doing your regular habit. Fourth, do a scheduled fasting or weekend fast. So, if this is your life, from Monday to Friday, you're studying, and then maybe at night you are working. So, you would just have to set your schedules. Remember, we have the synchronous and asynchronous classes, and it's set between Monday until Friday. So, if you have your synchronous classes, do your assignments during the asynchronous. Make sure that you do not bring any assignment over the weekend, because if you do so, you can do your fasting and detoxing. Okay, so here I have set here a Saturday morning as organization or community service work, because some of us are serving the barangays, serving in an NGO, serving as a Rotaract member. Okay. But still, put in your schedule your fasting and detoxing moments. Okay, so this one, we have Saturday and Sunday. There are times that I do my schedule. I'm offline, or even if there are some people messaging me, I will not entertain them because I just don't want to be bombarded with many issues or concerns during the weekend when it's already my time with my family. So remember, family matters. So this is now my challenge. How long can you do without your socials? Can you last 48 hours? Can you last for 1 week without your socials? So when we say socials, that would be the social media app, and we are referring to, again, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Okay, those are the three majors that we have. Fifth, this is very challenging because you have to find your detox buddies. So your detox buddies, these are your friends or your classmates whom, like you, would be detoxing at a particular time. So maybe when you are already online, that's the time that you can compare, oh, what have you done during the weekend? Were you successful? Oh, I thought you are going to have a new hobby. Were you able to do that? Okay, so if you keep on tracking them during the time that you're supposed to be detoxing, then you're not detoxing at all. Make sure that there are no posts, no liking, but just living. You can also find your detox buddies within your family, or have a challenge with your best friend, or even your boyfriend or girlfriend, or your partner. Number six, replace your social media time with a hobby. So let's follow the remove replace principle. So instead of dealing with Facebook, instead of looking at other people's timelines, why not try to do or find some hobby, just like maybe this, playing the kalimba, and that's a musical instrument. Or if you want, you can repaint your room or do some cooking. Maybe you can even find a business or establish a business because of that. Remember, you have to do social media responsibly. And in order to do that ethically, you have to think. Okay. Think before you post anything on your socials. And what do we mean by thinking? Mom, I always think before I post. I think if there are somebody who would be hurt with what I say, if there are people who would be bashed or bullied with what I say, yes, I'm thinking. But there are still many things that you have to think about before posting, and this would be it. Let's be guided by the word think itself. First, is it true? Do some fact checking before posting or sharing something. Beware of fake news. Okay, there are many students. There are some students that I have friended in Facebook. And the truth is that I can monitor your socials because you're my friend. Because I can see you in my timeline. Though at times when I check my timeline or the news feed, I would be seeing posts like 3 days ago, 4 days ago, because I'm not really into browsing my news feed. I rarely see things. Sometimes they say I'm so outdated. Well, I might be outdated for a week, 3 days, 4 days, but not really for a year. But it is not my habit. I barely do that browsing. Okay. And also the sharing. Okay. So what you can do is to always fact check before you post or share something. There are many issues that people would always write on and comment immediately, react immediately. This is what I always tell. There are always two sides of the stories. The one who experienced it, and then the other side is the ones commenting. And don't forget, there are ridges between those two sides, which means there are connections. But what would make those ridges solid? Okay. So it is not just your opinion, not just the other people's opinions. It's not just the opinion of those who experienced it. But you have to look at it at a 360 degree angle. But what we usually do is that when we saw one thing, we already react. We already comment. We already put our voice on it. Okay. So you have to be looking at the different clues to say that what you are posting is actually factual. And also beware of fake news, because there are times that the media is being used, or the media is actually the one spreading this fake news. So this is just a meme for this, wherein newspapers are being mentioned as fake news daily, providing misleading headlines and providing alternative facts. We are not in an alternative world, so you have to be very careful with this. There are already many disputes over rumors. Okay, so let's not add up to it. Second, is it helpful? Okay, will your post or article encourage or tear people down? Will it encourage or discourage? Is it helpful and not hurtful? So, think about this. The third is it inspiring? Are you inspiring other people? Will your post or your article inspire the other people? You can always post your passion, what you are doing. So if you see my timeline, you know that I'm very fond of animals. Okay? And show that what you do inspires other people. Okay. So it is very rare that you see my posts related to my work or my career. Because for me, my socials would be my personal life. Okay. So you have to aspire to inspire other people before you expire. Do not post something that will make other people think of expiring themselves. Rather, inspire them. Fourth, is it necessary? So this is one of the quotations that you will see on the net. Never before has a generation so diligently recorded themselves accomplishing so little. So it's like whatever you do, you're boasting it. You felt like, oh my god, it's hot. You boast it. It is hot, I want to go to the bathroom. You're boasting it. And those are your accomplishments, right? You can see your Facebook memories. And I'm also guilty of this. I would be seeing posts from 6 years ago. God, what was I thinking during that time? What would I be posting that? Okay, so think, is it necessary? Okay, you can always post, but you can limit the viewers of it. Okay, if you just want a record or documentation of your life, then maybe you can just make it private, wherein selected people can just see it, or maybe only yourself. This is the time you have this me generation. And I also have some people who are of my age, wherein you will see nothing but their selfies. Okay, so it's like, is there something wrong that you just want to have an everyday picture of yourself? Or are you documenting the changes in your face? Or even if you just use a rejuvenating cream, you post your selfie when you had modifications on your eyebrows, or maybe you had your brow tattoo, then you still post it. I don't know. There are really some people who even to the point that they are really posting just some stuff that are not really necessary. Okay, so because it is a me generation, yourself would always be important. If you are given attention, that's very important for you. If there are so many likes, if there are so many comments on your particular photo, then you are being uplifted by that. You are being motivated by that. Well, I don't think it's really that good. Okay, you have to reflect on this. So the Time magazine released the me generation, wherein the millennials are the so-called entitled narcissists. Is that true? Of course, you will become defensive of this. Okay. And according to that magazine, that you are the most threatening and exciting generation since the baby boomers brought about social revolution. Not because they are taking over the establishment, but because they are growing up without one. You might be thinking that your socials are just to connect with others, but sometimes your social is about advertising yourself. Lastly, is it kind? You have to practice kindness. Remember, when you post, think of it as, what if I am the recipient of my post? Okay? So, kindness is magic. To sum up, this session is a time for you to think. Think of your posts. Think of your news feeds. Think of your timeline. And imagine or reflect. Is it true? Is it helpful? Is it inspiring? Is it necessary? And is it kind? So these are the different ways that you can detox from your social media applications. Okay. And that would be the last leg. I hope that you learned throughout the 4 sessions on how you can actually overcome your social media addiction, and that will be done via detoxing. And do not forget to always think before you post. And that's it. Again, I am Abigail Gomez saying have a great day, everyone. Don't forget, think before you post. Bye.